Good morning, everybody. I hope you slept well. And we continue to think about why DH is somehow fascinating, but on the other hand, there are so many obstacles. And so this might be a talk between disillusion, illumination, and some enthusiasm. I will start with a quote by the Canadian Prime Minister. He answered on the question why he have 50% in his cabinet female ministers. And his answer was very simple: it's 2015. So what does mean it's 2016 in our field? And here's one answer, just an example. The first driverless magazine. This is a magazine in the field of business and design, and it is completely written by machines. So the pictures, the subtitles, the articles, they are all written by a machine. The machine has a name, you might be familiar with it, it's IBM Watson, so a huge group, I don't know how many hundred people are working for IBM to develop a machine learning algorithm who can learn from other magazines in this area how to build such a magazine. And it works, so maybe you can see it's a little bit short, but you can click on that and see how the journalists are sleeping because the machines are doing the work for them. Okay, this is not future, this is 2016, and it shows or illustrates somehow that the digital is now very obviously part of our daily life. It will change the world we are working in, and nobody exactly know what this second machine age, to name it or to phrase it this way, will mean for all of us. Well, we have an idea what it means in the humanities, and this is part of my talk. In humanities, it means mostly this. Okay, many of my colleagues would say, well, I use electronic library catalogs, I use scans of books, I use digital editions, bibliographies, dictionaries. Well, if I'm honest, I use also Wikipedia, because Wikipedia is pretty good in most articles. And some of them are using Google Books, which is, again, the largest library. But they would also answer, well, the evolution is a fine thing, we are growing up, and this is the summit of humankind, the scholar in itself, but the computer is somehow a deformation. And it makes us stupid in many respects. So Nicholas Carr, who is a smart man, but is very popular with arguments like that, that we are getting stupid and our boys getting fat and stupid and so on. So it's not as easy as we suspect, as we hoped when we start to go in this area. So I come from a university which some hundred years ago started to invent digital communication. This is what the mathematician Carl Friedrich Gauss and Wilhelm Weber started at the beginning of 19th century. They built a magnet, and by electronic or electric current, you can move the current to the left or to the right side. And they built an alphabet to communicate over a distance from about 1 kilometer. This was the beginning of digital communication. You have only two states, one is plus, one is minus, and you can communicate every text. And Samuel Morse make a business out of it. This is the difference between the German scientist and the American entrepreneur. Okay, so maybe Göttingen could be a typical place where we can go ahead and do better things with computers in this tradition. This is a long story, and I try to make this story short. Our Göttingen Center for Digital Humanities came into life, well, it's difficult to say one is really the first starting point, but we talked about very early, something like 10 years ago, because there was a growing interest in digital methods. There, people heard about that you can do more with library catalogs than before. You can use mathematical methods to measure books and so on. So there was a very unclear but first interest. We have a very important player, and some mentioned that it's, I think, not by accident that libraries are one of the driving forces to establish digital humanities. I think Göttingen is not an exception, it's a typical thing, because we are the only university library with an own department for of research and development, which is very uncommon in German libraries. So they have a known department who are looking for research, and some of you might be familiar with TextGrid and other initiatives. This is all done by this department. I think without our head of library, the first was a mathematician, then librarians who came from, well, open to all these digital areas, they help us, they force us, well, building groups. This was a very, very important factor in it. The second institutional factor was the computer center. We have the computer center together with Munich for the Max Planck Society, which is a key player in the German landscape of science and humanity, well, science in this case. And it's also the computing center for the university. And there's a strong interest from their side to include also the humanities. So they showed every year wonderful scores where you can see how many resources are used by especially elementary particle physicists. But from humanities, it's always a small bar of it. So they are simply have an interest to open it up. A third player was the Academy of Science. Maybe you're familiar. In Germany, we have a wide landscape. I don't know exactly the number. It's 15 or how many academies we have? Yeah, but in Germany, there are more than eight. Huh? Okay, it depends how much you count. Okay, so it depends a little bit what you count as an academy. And the major, why it is important, they run a lot of cultural heritage projects, and all these projects have to be transformed from a printed era into a digital era, and they need a lot of support to do this, and I have no exact idea how to do this. So there's a simple interest in that. And we have other partners, what we call the Göttingen Research Campus. So we have not only the university, but we have institutions like the Herzog-August Library, which is a library specifically for early modern stuff. And we have five Max Planck Institute, Fraunhofer Institute, and so on. And they all said, well, it would be nice to have a platform where digital initiatives could come together. So there's a growing landscape 10 years ago, I think. And this is what we do. So we first thought that digital humanities is something between the disciplines. So on the one side, maybe you can read it, computer science, information science on the bottom, then digital humanities between, and the discipline from coptology to archaeology on the top. But somehow it's between the disciplines. We all shared an understanding that understand culture in a manner of data makes a lot of sense. This is not cultural deprivation. It's okay to think about culture in a data way. Digital addition were at the core, at the beginning, but a first idea about quantitative analysis of cultural texts and objects came up. We invited colleagues from computer science, like Daniel Keim, about visualization and finding patterns. And we had a little bit debates about whether we need a critical thinking about the digital modernization as part of such a thing. But we have no idea whether the age is a discipline in its own, or whether this should become part of all the disciplines in themselves. Should we foster digital archaeology, digital coptology, digital social science, politics, and so on, or whether we should build a larger department for DH? This was an open question and it wasn't really answered. Which is a problem, we will see in a minute. So the goals were very simple. I think most of us share these goals, is getting scholars involved. Can we do that? Can we convinced them. We were very enthusiastic and think this would be not a problem. If we just offer that, shows the tools, the opportunity, they would come, which was a mistake, of course. We think about to build a study program also for teachers, because one of the major topics in German humanities is we educate the teachers, and the teachers are confronted with all the digital modernization from games, from Twitter, WhatsApp, and so on, and we say nothing to them how to handle with these digital modernization which came up in their classrooms. So we have no idea, but we think about that would be really an important topic, and every discipline in the humanities would accept this and said, well, we can improve teachers' education if we invest a little bit more in that. And we thought about from the beginning to develop a PhD program. So there are funding lines from the German Research Council, the DFG, in this direction. And there's still no graduate school until today in DH in Germany, which is really a pity. And of course, summer schools would be easier. And to offer infrastructure, services, workspace. So you can run machines in the computing center, building virtual research environment like TextGrid, and a topic from the beginning, because we have libraries on board of the center, long-term preservation was a really important topic. And what came out is an institution, well, the Göttingen Center for Digital Humanities, run by many faculties together under the supervision of the Department of Philosophy. The head of the State Library was the born member of the board, so we have always the head of the library as part of the steering committee. We have the computing center, the grid center, we have the Academy of Science within, and other partners like the Herzog August Library and the Max Planck Society. This works very well together. It's easy to handle, build these structures, and we have some bylaws, which depends, of course, on the legal structure of our university, but it was easy to build in the end. Okay. So typical projects we are running are projects like Edition. This is a typical project in some respect. Blumenbach is the guy, is very important if you're using terms in some countries like Caucasian race. It goes back to Blumenbach, because Blumenbach was very important in the pre-Darwin world for natural science. So Goethe, Humboldt, all people, Joseph Banks in England, refer to Blumenbach and his thinking about the varieties of humans and animals, or humans as animals together. And what we want to do there is to have a text editions together with the objects. We have thousands of objects, we have skulls. Here on the left-hand side, the beautiful Georgian woman where we all come from. This is, well, we are all coming from Georgia somehow, but also stones or a needle of a porcupine, because it was very unclear what a mammal is around 1800. So you can search the whole text now and look onto the details of the objects and understand how the objects influence the thinking about natural history. This is pre-Darwinian, but it's very important in many respects to understand what's the order, the taxonomy of nature is, and what's the position of man. It's not easy to run a TI edition together with objects, because describing objects is a lot of work, a lot of handwork, but it's a very typical thing. In the end, it's easy, and we try now to transform the whole thing in a more advanced area, so triple IF standards, and make use of the new standards is a huge thing, but in the end we are able to do that. This is not really difficult. Well, it's difficult, but it's there are established standards to do this. So one part of the center is to help these kinds of editions to become a little bit better than before. Second thing is that we try to involve other partners. This is an example. I'm running research with my colleagues on Kafka's diaries. So we take established questions about in the field of Kafka research, so whether his early writings differs more or less from his so-called late writings. Well, Kafka was died very early, so or young, not early. And so we take questions established in a field, here in this case literary studies, and use psychometric methods to understand how things changed. And this is a method mostly developed by James Pennebaker, a psychologist in Austin, Texas. And we are looking in the use of words, like here in this case, emotion words. And you see that there's coming up a more abstract style with a lot of negative emotions in the late writings of Kafka's diary. And we can somehow, well, decide questions, old questions already established in the field of humanities by new methods. This is the major thing. And I think most what we do in this center is taking old questions, like from Kafka research, and try to answer in a new methodological way. And hopefully, the validation of our findings is a little bit better than the common way. This is the promise behind. We use more advanced methods inspired by Jan Rybicki and Maciej Eder and this wonderful... okay. Well, so you're familiar with things like stylometry with R. This is really inspiring, and all the time I teach this with my students. Well, this is mind-blowing, and here's a very simple, again, a note question. What's the position of Heinrich von Kleist, the German drama writer around 1800, between neoclassicism and romanticism? So is he more or less somebody in the romantic camp, or is he in the neoclassical camp? Again, an old question transformed by new methods. It's a consensus tree, so a lot of dendrograms behind, together with photos. I'm looking into it, and you see Kleist is very much an author in its own. He builds a species in its own. This is very much this kind of display mapping. The similarities between texts is displayed in a manner inspired by biological models. And it shows that Kafka is mostly a species on its own. It's a branch in its own. But if you look more closely, there's one exception. Kleist-Kätchen. So if you're a specialist in this area, you know why. This is the only play where Kleist tried to imitate romantic writing. It's a romantisches Ritterschauspiel, that's the subtitle of it, a romantic knight's play. And by imitating the romanticism, he builds a species in its own, because he's not a romantic writer. He is somehow special. In many respects. So he's between the camps. He's not on the one or on the other camp. He's somehow special. This is an example where we use, well, statistical models, thanks to Jan and Maciej, tools within R. So it's a package in R, where we, in the end, looking mostly for the most frequency words. We are counting words. And if I explain this to most of my colleagues, I say, how could you simply collecting words in bags and compare these bags say something about a style or the specificity of a writer? And the interesting thing, it works. So it's somehow disturbing for most of my colleagues, but somehow they accepted it because they could understand what's going on there. That's okay. But again, it's a typical project where we use absolutely established scholarly questions and transform them by new methods, by new tools, and to answer them in a better way. So this is the good message behind. Where are we now after 10 years? Well, we have in the end really got the opportunity to involve scholars and social scientists. They came in from very different direction. We didn't expect that Coptologists are so open, but the background is very simple. They're coming from Australia and they're an English-speaking world where computers are not the enemy. This is very simple, the reason. Some social scientists, but the number is very, very limited. It's not a conversion, a mass conversion, where people say, wow, that's really fancy, I would love to use these methods. It's not happening. So we are much behind what we expected that would happen in many areas. Even in an area where you would think, well, there is no other thing than digital archaeology, well, archaeologists are interested, but one is very much interested and the other, well, limited. So it's even in areas like archaeology, not as easy as we expected. In teaching, well, we have a study program, but only in the area of computer science, because the computer scientists were very open. They hoped to attract new students, especially female students, because this is in Germany a very boyish thing. So they were open, they helped to offer bridging courses, because people with a more or less humanistic background have many obstacles to overcome to get into this field, but a known PhD program, a known master program is still an open question. So it's very limited, again, here our results. Well, we were very successful, mostly thanks to the university library and the Academy of Science, in building infrastructure. So this is just a little excerpt. So we are engaged in DARIA and the umbrella structure for DARIA EU with Mike Mertens and others in the European Alliance of Academies, ALEA. We are in CentreNet, we are engaged in DHD, so the German-speaking DH communities. But this is often done and fostered by the library and the computing center. So I think Christoph already mentioned it. I think one of our little success stories we can tell here is to build these digital humanities German-speaking countries, so it's Switzerland, Austria, and Germany together, not as a separate organization, but from the beginning, simply as a chapter in the European and in the ATO, so the Alliance of Digital Humanities Organization worldwide. And I think at the moment we're one of the biggest, well, numbers is not important, but it shows the conferences we start, the first in Passau, we think about 100 people would join this, it was 250, and nowadays it's mostly between 400 to 500 people joining this conference, which means that the German-speaking DH community conferences are larger than, in my field, German study program conferences. This is weird. So. And people coming from all walks of life, from archives, from libraries, from computing centers, from academies, and from disciplines. So this is a success story, one of the few. And many projects are visible here, like OCR initiatives and others. What we are currently doing in Göttingen is building an infrastructure similar to the social science. So if you're doing research in social science in Germany, there's the GESIS, which is an infrastructure where you can put your research primary data onto it. They take care of the whole thing, especially complicated law issues. So you have videos of kindergarten children playing around. You can't make it easily available because there's so many misuse of things like that. And there's an infrastructure for social science, but not for humanities. So we came up with the idea to first have a design phase, a two-year design phase, to build a similar thing for the humanities. And now this year, 2016, it now really starts a humanities data center for your primary research data in the humanities, which helps you to connect your findings, because often the datas are in a silo and not connected to anything else, not part of catalogs and whatever, and their specialist who helps you to put the right metadata to it and connect the data. Of course, we haven't found yet the crystal ball for long-term preservation. If we do it, I will spread it out, but still open. But it's an issue here, long-term preservation, how we could make data stable. And of course, there's teaching and counseling. It just starts. And we will see whether there's a strong interest in the humanities to make the data available and a little bit more open than in reality. What works also very well is, or are, summer schools and workshops. We could have, well, we have some years three or four, so Jan was also teaching here, or Mike Kestermond and Lars Wieneke here on this picture. I'm not quite sure whether you can see this. Really great teaching, and all the people coming, they are coming from all walks of life, they are coming from all parts of Europe. We try to find money, especially to enable students or colleagues from countries with less money to stay for a week and just to learn things. And many who joined these Python, R, 3D, GIS, RTE, photography, or whatever it is, these people have mostly no clear idea. They have just a sense it's important. It could help to improve my work if I would get the opportunity to learn 1 week with the smartest mind a new thing. And that is, in the end, the most encouraging thing. And it often happens that there will be no lunch, and about 7 o'clock in the evening, some people say, oh, I'm so feel so bad. Is there anything? A pizza? Yeah, okay. Because they work really 7-8 hours through is really incredible. So this is the most inspiring thing we can do, and we learned a lot. So just 2 weeks ago, argument analysis, never heard about how this works, and we learned about a lot how difficult it is. And we try to get money from different sides, especially to enable students from all walks of life to participate on things like that. So that's a good thing, and I think everybody should do more in this. Another very simple thing is to have once a month a brown bag lunch. It's just between 1 or 12 o'clock and 2 o'clock something. Everybody brings his brown bag, and somebody talks about his or her current research. Just a quarter, 20 minutes, tell a little bit what's going on. And one of the findings nearly every time is, well, you do that, I do nearly the same. And we have no clue about. Even if it's the same department, nobody talks with one another. I don't know why scholars and social scientists are so limited in just simply learn. Maybe we can discuss this, but this is a very easy, low-level thing, nothing to organize except a room and an email, and then just come together and please talk about your work, make it visible in a very simple way. We had also, thanks to Marco Büchler and other very encouraging colleagues, a variety of talks on topics, well, it could be much more, but a good example is Christine Borgmann talking about big data and little data. What, there's such a hype about big data, and what does it mean, big data, in which respect, and things like that. But the number of people joining such a talk is very, very limited. We expected something like 100 people coming from all parts of the university, because big data is an issue in chemistry and all, and she's one of the best experts in that. Well, it's only limited. I don't know exactly how we can improve this. Or Joffrey and Bettina, they talked about ethical constraints. What are we allowed to upload everything we find in digital humanities? Maybe not, but what are the criteria for that? Well, I think also very important issues, but in the end, the reflection and the criticism on the digital modernization is still underdeveloped, at least in my university, and I think in most German universities. It's not really a public debate. It's dominated by newspapers who normally have these very critical things, like Eggers, the circle. This is the whole view on the internet age, and it's, I think, too simple. Okay, so here we can do a lot more, and we should include the growing landscape of the digital-born stuff, and this is only in my area, I have some PhD students working in this, there are millions of people writing and reading and doing literary criticism every day. So it's about, Wattpad is the largest group in this, you have 100,000 news stories every day. Yeah? And people are very critical on these issues. It's not just simply, I'm writing my story and that's the whole thing, please appreciate it. No, they're critical, there's a literary criticism on that. Maybe you're familiar with the major mistakes you can do in areas like fan fiction. So the major error you don't do, please, is writing a Mary Sue story. Anybody familiar with that? No? Okay, Mary Sue is, I'm coming to Hogwarts, and Harry Potter is looking at me and fall in love immediately. And this is not a good story. So don't do mistakes like that. And there are many debates about these issues. And for the first time, we can look at real-time cultural developments on a scale unprecedented in the whole world. Maybe we can do more about it, just looking in Goodreads. Who was that? Was it Ted Underwood or Andrew Piper? Who look how Trump supporters and Clinton supporters, which books they share on their shelf. This is I'm not quite sure who's the, somebody? So it's Ted or Andrew. And this is a wonderful idea just to look on the shelves where you know that this person is a Clinton or a Trump supporter, and you have thousands of numbers, and then look, where's the overlap? Is there anything they share, or is America completely divided? And that's an opportunity, a kind of research you can't do, 5 years ago, but now you can do. And well, we should think how we can include this more. Or new formats, so you maybe have heard about Mr. Darcy and Lizzie, these Pride and Prejudice stories by somebody called Jane Austen or so. This is retold thousands of times in video blogs and Twitter novels, where it seems to be that Lizzie is actually writing to Mr. Darcy and Mr. Darcy is answering her. Or there are books out you can't print, like Ralph Larson's Entrances and Exit, who makes use of Google Street Views. And without Google Street Views, you can't read the story. You have to read it on your phone. And Ralph Larson is an established, also in the book world, author. This is not anyone. That's fantastic. So we have a wide variety of new phenomenon in the area of the digital and how to include it. And we do nothing in the humanities at that moment. We try, this is one simple thing we do. We founded Cost Action. It's called eRead. All European countries are involved under the leading of the Stavanger Reading Center and the Netherlands, Adrian van der Weel and, And the idea is to understand better how is reading changing in the digital age. So can we remember anything, getting our boys fat and stupid by the reading on tablets and so on? What's really is the change? But this is not part in our university research. It's just a European initiative, and I think it's very helpful to do that, but it's not still part of a digital humanities center. Another initiative just came up, so our Ministry for Education and Science asked the German landscape of universities to build a German Internet Institute. Well, we are one of the last, not Göttingen, in that case mostly Hanover, the computer science department, but we are the cultural and the law part of it. Of course, it will in the end go to Berlin because the better connections, I think that will be the answer about this competition, but okay, forget it. But this is a typical thing, though there's a demand by politicians and from all sides to do more and to give an understanding what's going on in the digital modernization, and there's no institution, at least in Germany. There's no Oxford Internet Institute or Roy Rosenzweig Center in Germany, nothing like that. So just different initiatives who think about this. So if I look here, are we now a discipline? What are we in Göttingen? I think one lesson we have learned is that just offering infrastructure, offer teaching, many abilities, tools, methodology is not enough. We have to do more, or maybe we give up to convert our colleagues and said, well, the digital is our future and we have to think more closely about it. And somebody mentioned it, this paper about bamboo, why it failed. There are so many things which happen similar in other areas. The major thing is that most people, if they are interested, most colleagues are only interested to learn one specific tool, one specific method, and then they are out. They are not stick to the field, they are not sharing their experience. They just want to improve their very limited tunnel of perspective views, and then they are out. This is not a long-term engagement in the whole thing, or only a small number. We have not a study program, or while flourishing a study program, we have no institute, so we can offer nothing for an identity. Something like coming together, we try to have even Christmas parties, so we try to build some sort of identity, but well, in the end we reach mostly those who are already converted and it's a limited number. And we should think about whether we want to expand this. So the first point is here, maybe in most scholarly research we need no collaboration to find the particles we are interested in. We can do it pretty good alone. And the best thing I can do is ignore my colleagues, ignore my students, because we have the German Beamten system. So if you have no students, if you have no contacts to your colleagues, you can write your books. And that's the most successful way in German academia, in scholarly field. That's the reason why we would never stand in a room together and clap and say, wow, we find together something. So we need some sort of research, and I'm very grateful to initiatives like shown yesterday by Frédéric Caplan, where we can think about in a bigger picture than we normally do, because most projects are so limited, which means I need no contact to my colleagues, or better, no contact, I'm better. In the teaching area, I think there is a need. I know from Würzburg, from Darmstadt, and now recently in Leipzig, they started a DH program, and it's about 50 to more than 100 bachelor students inscribing for such a study program. There is a need, and it depends on us to offer that. I'm especially, because one of my major jobs is to educate teachers, and I think we should offer our teachers an understanding about what's going on in the digital area. They have no idea how Facebook is working. They're using it, but that's all. That's the same their students are doing, and I think we should do more in this. Since, I don't know, 4 or 5 years, Jörg, you might correct me, we think about we should establish a PhD program. There's a fantastic tool in the German Research Council, especially for international, so we can have 2 or 3 international partners in a graduate school and offer a PhD program, solely based on digital humanities research. That would be, I think, a game changer, at least in the German area. Third thing I started, and this is, I redefine my own research, is building research groups, because normally PhD students or master students and even bachelor students, they just do their work, I have to correct them, and mostly I'm, to be honest, not very much interested in the results. Because these results are typical, you reread Goethe's Wahlverwandtschaft or something like that, and I know the results. So now I have first-time students who really offer me new insights. I'm so excited, even by bachelor students. I try to convince them to stay. So Cosima, some of you might heard her. Now she stayed in in Göttingen, and I offered her to went to go to James Pennebaker to the US to get in contact with these. Cost me a lot of money, but I invest in these people, money and time, because I get something back I can't do by my own. So I try to imitate my colleagues in the natural science and try to build at least 2-3, maybe up to 5 students who are working in the same area of cultural analytics. Or I'm very much fascinated about the new developments in cultural evolution. Whether I can attract students to do this, of course I have to offer courses in this to make the topic visible, but for the first time, or Łukasz Gagala from Wrocław, who came from my Kastemont, doing manuscript culture, and he can do things I can't do. So this is one of the major problems. I have to change my position, and sometimes there's only one stupid person in the room, that's me, and the students are smarter. This is a big change for me, but I think this is what we have to do, really build stable research groups, try to get funding, make us attractive to get the best students to run this kind of research. This is an example I do with Frank Fischer. Maybe you're familiar with his name because he's one of the new heads of DARIA EU. We try to understand a very simple problem. What is world literature? What authors is the world sharing? And we thought about, well, there might be one indicator, it's Wikipedia. Well, it's not one Wikipedia, there's 26 languages and so on. And we try to develop measurements, how to measure which author, not works, but author, is most interested for the world audience, according to Wikipedia. Of course, we know Wikipedia is not the world population, it's mostly male, it's mostly well-educated, young people writing at Wikipedia. But again, maybe you can see the name in the middle, it's William Shakespeare, it's the absolutely hero of the whole thing. But even Stephen King on the left side is really popular. And we think about what could be the best measurement. Is it the length of the article? Is it the revision history of the article? Is it the in-links or the out-links, things like that. And we try to measure these and develop things. But in this kind of research, we have at least 6 people working together. Some from the computer science department in Hannover, so it's 30 minutes away from Göttingen. Frank Fischer, who is in Moscow, so it's not around the corner, and things like that. So, and the major thing is done by a master student. So we write the idea for this paper, and a master student said, okay, I'm interested in, I'm working is, and he's the first author of this paper, which will be hopefully printed the next months. Okay. This is a typical research group project. Open access, of course, we are involved in many open access things, but for many parts of research, we are doing, somehow, we talked yesterday evening, pirate things. So we try to collect a corpus of text around Kafka to understand how specific Kafka is writing in comparison to other writers. We crack mostly ebooks because there's no corpus available. So we have a simple problem that we can't publish our research. We first thought, okay, we made a corpus of literary modernism available to the world and everybody can look into details of our research and reuse this corpus. This is not allowed because this is illegal done corpus building. So it's not as easy as we expected. It's illegal. There's no other term for that, but we are doing this. And we are encouraging our students, because I'm not the only one, but Professor Hilti, who's the head of the copyright Max Planck Institute in Munich, said, well, civil disobedience is the only way to overcome this old stuff, copyright law. Okay, so this is just an example of how complicated it is. We built also a little scholars lab, which sounds, well, very big, but it's a small funding to encourage. So one very simple thing is people from archaeology to get a 3D scanner to scan their sculptures and stuff they have, very simple things, but to get a little bit of funding improves research on a specific area a lot, or in political science they are looking into Twitter analysis and things like that. You need not a lot of money, but a little bit of seed money to improve this kind of research. So this might be also a very simple measurement. It's not costly for a university, but our new vice president said we need a scholar labs which are shared. And well, in physics, it's not a problem to think about in X-ray physics to share the apparatus across the disciplines. But what could it be in humanities? And we said, well, we have an idea of a tools, teaching, a little bit of machinery, and that's the whole thing. It's not expensive, but it works. Here I come to my a main point where I have no real answer to it. I think we are using more and more methods in a more and more sophisticated way. We started very simple, because I'm not the only simple mind in my department, but one of them. And to understand how these methods work takes a lot of time. I'm not trained. Most of my colleagues are not trained in mathematical and statistical methods. We need that. There is no way out to run a really good DH method without a core knowledge, not a basic, a core knowledge in statistics and some mathematical methods. Not real mathematics from the perspective of mathematicians and statisticians, but some understanding how a Shannon entropy could be counted or developed, things like that. So we try to build groups and using books like von Bayen or, of course, Matthew Chalker's macroanalysis and other books. But still, we need teaching books about this, specifically for people with no statistical background, which is the normal thing. We have no statistics center like in social science, so we need we have to build it. So here's one example by Stefan Ewert. He's one of the smart guys in statistics. We are using always these Ewert delta, Burris delta, and so on. Why are they working? And why are they working differently? We need an understanding. So he's looking how many features we need to include to get a stable outcome in findings. Just to get a better understanding, we can't use these methods as a black box. This is not science, this is magic. So we need to understand, so we invited people like Stefan Ewert to teach on a Friday afternoon basics in this area. And we learned a lot, and we understand that we do not know anything about this area. This is really a lot of work, and I think it takes 2-3 years to improve things like that. Go on his website, it's really mind-blowing. You find a lot of stuff. Stefan Ewert, I can recommend at Erlangen Nürnberg. He's one of those few people who really try to make sense what we are doing in digital humanities in detail. So the problem is, what is our idol? Whether we are looking like the Rembrandt scholar. This is, so give one example. One colleague you might know, or some of you might know, Matt Manson, is working in New Testament research. Normally, we professors are simply smarter than our students because we are older, we have read more. This is so simple. This helps you, you have more knowledge. Now, young people like Matt Manson step into the field using methods you have no clue, and the professor, well, I'm not sure whether this is really science, and that's the reason why he went to Gregory Crane to Leipzig and not working in the New Testament research department, because they would say, I have no idea what you're doing, but I feel that you are somehow criticizing my position as a scholar, like on your left-hand side. So maybe on the other side, should we offer a nerd identity? I think we need a little bit to make, or to offer students, to make them special, to feel somehow I know things most people, most normal of my co-fellows have no idea about. And if we can offer something like that, is helpful. Maybe not completely on this nerdic side, but somehow it's okay. I have no trouble with that. So this is still open. So I'm not quite sure what the development will be, and this will be my final here, whether we should make DH more part of every discipline. So in my field, German or literary studies, well, the next professor in German studies should be somebody who has also, or she has also, abilities in statistical methods and so on, or whether we should build DH in as a discipline. I think we need both. If you're looking in other areas like computational chemistry or physics, biology, bioinformatics, geographical science, they have always specific professorships in this area who do nothing more, or they do developing methods, tools, improve these methods, evaluate the methods, and so on. You can't do it just on the fly. So I think we need this. At which scale, I have no clue about. On the other side, we need more professors who do it on an everyday basis in their field and said, well, there's no discussion about to use computers in literary studies or in archaeology or art history. It should be normal. But it's not normal science, at least in Göttingen, and I can say for most German university, it is not. So this was a long talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your very interesting talk. And now the floor is open for questions, for discussion. So if you have any question, comment. Yes, please. Here. I'm sorry. So and you will be the next.
Gerhard, thank you so much. Too many ideas to comment on. The picture that you're painting is interesting because it's very, I think, sincere and true. It's a little of good things and a little of bad things. Mm-hmm. I mean, your talk is not the first in this conference that confirms the sad fact that the mm-hmm. model build the center and build methods and they will come mm-hmm. is not working.
It's not working, yes.
And of course, that is, I mean, the raison d'etre of DH centers at universities is still valid as a place where the digital humanists will congregate. Mm. But without big outreach campaigns, we won't get anywhere. Yeah. So the only way in which we can reach the traditional scholars in the humanities is infiltrating. Mm-hmm. and it's not because they won't come in big numbers to even the biggest digital humanities conference.
Yeah, exactly.
I know.
Yeah.
Next April we have this a triennial conference in English studies in Krakow that my institute organizes, mm-hmm. and there, out of the three keynote speakers, one will be an eminent British stylometrist.
Okay,
but that's a first. Okay. I mean, it's they don't get invited to traditional conferences mm-hmm. a lot, and I think that's the only way.
Yeah.
We have to stop preaching to the choir because I mean yeah. we're all friends here. We all share the same
exactly.
ideas.
That makes now, no sense.
That is not the way to go. We have to go out, infiltrate, show that this works. There's quite a lot of, despite what you might think, among traditional humanists, there's quite a lot of people who are tired of the postmodern nihilism and relativism in epistemology of the humanities. So this our new approaches, which of course are not entirely objective, but which sort of go down to the facts, might be very, very interesting. Very interesting. I mean, I've had experiences of that. So that's just one reaction to your excellent talk that I have off the top of my head.
Yeah. So one illustrative moment was we ran a conference in the 90s to oppose this very common view about the death of the author. And we asked John Burroughs to write an article. So we published this volume, The Return of the Author, and from that point on, nobody uses this death of author way of thinking anymore as easily as before. But nobody quoted John Burroughs. For us, he's a hero, no question. But to infiltrate means we need a lot of time and a long breath to say, well, even for basic question, what's the role of author in relation to the text and to other authors and literary history and so on? It's a basic question, and there's a very interesting answer, and they could ignore it. And this is, in scholarship, it's possible to ignore wide areas of research, not only digital, so cognitive science is the same, yeah. Sorry, yeah. But in the end, we need... Keep on knocking. That's... Thank you.
And there is one more question.
Thanks for the great talk. I'll try to keep it short because there's one more question coming. I was sort of thinking of the last slide you put there with this distinction between DH as a discipline and DH as a infiltrating current into the, like, all disciplines. And what I'm starting to think about is that probably the question is about the goal we want to achieve. So maybe it's, the goal is not like making all the people doing or understanding this stuff, but are using it. Like, for instance, like we're using, like literary scholars use history, social science, research, or something like that. So, and therefore, my question would be, and probably that could be also open question for the discussion later on, what would be the most effective practice, you know, in your experience to actually drag people in, to convince colleagues to use such research, to quote this research, to get interesting? What would be the most effective, you know?
It's very simple. If we want to understand what infiltration means, it means that everybody of us is part of a department. And the next position open, not to convert all, but to have one more colleague, female or male colleague, who is open, who's interested. And we have, so Thomas Weitin, so in Germany, is a good example, coming from a very traditional background, start to step into DH and now get an offer by the Technical University of Darmstadt and doing wonderful research. And now we have a new guy in our field, and this is a game changer. I think in the end, it's just names. It's the human factor. Again, it's so simple. So if everybody of us look a little bit to when the next position is open, say, well, a second denomination of it. It could be German studies or archaeology, but with digital methods or whatever it is. Yeah, that would be a game changer.
Okay, thanks a lot, Gerhard. Just a couple of ideas to probably address this from a more general and strategic perspective. I think there's a couple of potential mechanisms that we haven't really taken cognizance of as DH activists in a systematic fashion. One is we have to look at the career structures in various environments. If you're in a UK centered tenure track environment, things work differently than to how they work in Germany, where you're a civil servant, and basically once you've become a professor and you're in your position, you can forget about the rest of the world. So the motivation is rather different depending on the context. So we have to take cognizance of that. B, we have to take cognizance of the age structure in academia. To put it very bluntly, it doesn't make a lot of sense to try and convert somebody who's 50 plus.
No, this is, I wouldn't
yes.
say.
Yes. I'm ageist. I'm 50 plus. So, really, you have to factor in what is the career path, what is the research path, how long do projects work, what is the chances for somebody who's a senior colleague that they will change their research paradigm. What would motivate them to do that? Third point, I think we must target in particular those who enter academia as new colleagues. Those are the ones who might be much more interested in scouting around and in finding out what we are offering. And the fourth point I'd like to make is it is amazing how little outreach is built into many of the big European infrastructure environments and initiatives. I know that. I ran the only Daria DE sub-project on dissemination in the academic communities, and when money got tight, it was the first one to be scrapped again, which is really telling. So we have these big initiatives, and they don't really invest into outreach. So the only solution to that is that we build it into our own research fund applications, which we have to do as those senior colleagues who are interested in DH. We must factor that into our funding applications. It must become part of our research projects. Those are instruments which we would have to explore systematically, and they are context dependent. They will be different in every context, but we're lacking that kind of strategic approach.
Yeah, I consent. Just there are many, are there?
Yes, please. And I am extremely sorry, but we are running out of time, so your question will be the last, and next we will discuss during the coffee break.
Thank you for this great presentation. And I actually also had a few comments to build on this. So I really think that we are not thinking enough about why is it that, first of all, I want to say I'm an anthropologist who is actually observing digital humanities and studying and so on. So, you know, whenever I hear all those terms like conversion or we should be better and things like that, I react to that. And I think that if you want to think about why is that conversion is not happening, we should probably also take into consideration what kind of terminology are we using and how are we thinking about that. Like, do we really want to think and talk about conversion? Or do we want to think about transformation, education, things like that? I think that it is not the value system. Through terminology like conversion, we are implying that it is a value system. And I think that it is often not. It is often a matter of very pragmatic things. Like you mentioned, for example, that you need to learn statistics, mathematics, and so on. People do not have the time to do that.
Yeah.
People are not paid to do that. If you had built into a professor's time, even if they are 50 plus, the time, paid time, to learn about digital tools and methods, it would be better. And I also wanted to say, it seems to me that, you know, if after several decades of humanities computing and then digital humanities and so on, that kind of change has not really happened on the scale that we wanted, maybe the field itself needs to look at why it did not happen.
Yeah.
What is really happening? What is it that it is offering in terms of methods, in terms of tools, and so on? So those were really some of the basic questions.
You're absolutely right. I have a lot of talks, well, every second week, and I often use a propeller and other stuff, looking very conservative, and explain that digital humanities is something invented in early modern times and 19th century stuff. I tell a complete different story. Here, I'm preaching to the choir, but in another way, I have a really different narrative and say that this is humanities, this is scholarship, but using more and more the methods and the questions already established, but now with the computer, it's easier than using cards. things like that. So very simple examples I use, because otherwise it's, of course, dangerous. Yes. Yeah, you're right. Yes. Yeah.
Well, I would like just to add a very short comment, because I think that we also should think about changing the paradigm that computers are for mathematicians and other physicians, science. And this could begin at schools. Mm. And I'm not sure if how we can influence how children are taught in schools, because although they have informatics, this is not exactly the digital humanities, and during lessons of humanities, there are no computers at all. And if it doesn't change, and students learn about that, they can also use, students of humanities learn that can use computers in their research, it's too late, I'm afraid. So this is a very short comment.
Yeah, if you looked into the recent data from OECD about education in Germany, we lack in natural science. Mm. Because all the mathematical methods, computer-based methods, are not really appreciated in the German school system. And we can change it, because I'm responsible for teacher education, and I do not enough.
Thank you once again very much.